As the final battle for the Omniverse rages on, the heroes of the DC Universe will need to come face to face with their own dark reflections if they ever hope to win the day. What'll happen next? Well, let's hop into the pages of Dark Knight's Death Metal, The Last 52, War of the Multiverses, issue number 1, and find out together. Alright then, everyone, so this is yet another anthology story taking place directly after the events of Death Metal issue number 6. You'll recall in that story, Wonder Woman had unlocked the true potential power of truth, and in doing so was able to open up all of her chakras and go Super Saiyan Ultra Instinct Super Saiyan or something like that. Geez, I don't know, there's just something about Wonder Woman right now, but I just cannot put my finger on it.
Biggest man in the world now, and you're covered in gold.
The Darkest Knight continues to gloat and give grandiose villainous speeches about how the heroes will never be able to defeat him because he is their true reflection, and that darkness and cruelty is the only real truth in the entire Omniverse, etc., etc. I hope you enjoy villains giving speeches just like this, because I swear all of the stories here are about 90% that. And with that, the Darkest Knight unleashes what he calls his final nightmares, evil versions of superheroes from across his newly created Earths. But wait, I thought Superboy Prime destroyed those Earths in his own special tie-in from last week, or maybe he just destroyed some of them, or most of them. You know what, it doesn't really matter at this point. Now, believe it or not, on top of everything else that Death Metal is doing with the multiverse and continuity and crisis and being a comedy and being a meta story, they also find time to try and address fan anger over heroes in crisis. No, I'm not making this up. You see, we run into an evil version of Wally West who calls himself the fastest killer alive, and yes, that is most definitely a broken psycho pirate mask like the one from Sanctuary that he's wearing. Real Wally swoops on in to stop him and grabs all the bullets before they can shoot his friends, before giving a little bit of a speech about how he'll never let himself become this dark and twisted, and that the horrible thing he did won't define him because he did it once as an accident. But hey, don't just take his word for it, because we also have Zombie Arsenal, who was resurrected by Black Lantern Batman in the previous issue. He's here to not only help Wally defeat his evil counterpart, but actually forgive him. Also, hey, thanks to the one fan on Twitter who pointed out to me that when Zombie Roy tipped his hat to Wally in the previous anthology story, it was literally a recreation of Tom King's own Twitter avatar. Now that's more or less the wraparound story dealt with, because from there we get a bunch of single stories, and I'm not going to cover every single one, because if I did, I'd be here all day, and Death Metal has already been going on for what feels like an eternity. So let me just give you some quick fire thoughts on some of the stories that I enjoyed or some of the ones I found interesting. First up, we've got a Superman family story that sees the House of El going up against a whole group of evil Supermen. The big rub being that Superman himself actually refuses to hit his evil doppelgangers, instead actively trying to appeal to their own better angels because, well, if they are Clarks and they are Supermen, then there is a chance that hope and light still exists in them somewhere. This pacifist run ultimately doesn't do much to convince the evil Superman, who are pretty stuck in their ways, but it does ultimately inspire not only Superman's own family of characters, but even villains like Lex Luthor and General Zod to not only get involved, but actually fight harder than they probably would have before, seeing Superman, who even though he may be their enemy, is ultimately a protector of life and they want to live. Batman gets a little story to himself in this collection too, wherein he once again does battle with the Batman Who Laughs. But wait, wasn't he dead, you're thinking? Didn't he become the Darkest Knight? Well, Batman had taken his corpse and was hoping to use it to his advantage in the final battle. Unfortunately, that came back to bite him in the ass, and essentially this story is just Batman and Batman Who Laughs endlessly trying to one-up each other. But because they're both Batman, they're both prepared, and because of that, they just keep going around in circles forever, which honestly feels like the last couple times Batman and Batman Who Laughs fought each other. Now, probably the most unexpected hero to get a spotlight story here is Ryan Choi, the Atom of all people. He and Mr. Terrific try and find a scientific solution to all this end-of-the-world stuff by resurrecting the Metal Men of all people. A big issue with a lot of these stories is that they kinda have beginnings and middles. A lot of the times they just have middles, but they don't really have any ends to them. Now, the most creative story in this collection is, believe it or not, a Lois Lane little vignette wherein she finds herself fighting an evil version of herself from an alternate world wherein Lois became an anti-superhero crusader. Lois teams up with Maxima of all people too, and honestly, this is just a fun pairing. I would have liked to have seen this expanded out into a full story and not just a short little one here in this anthology. Helps a lot too that evil Lois from an alternate Earth actually has a super cool costume. I'm a big fan of oversized gauntlets, if you couldn't tell. The Titans have yet another story in this anthology too that sees them going up against a group of evil Titans who killed their former heroes in their own world. This team is also led by an even more evil version of Raven, who had fully embraced her Trigun powers. Evil Raven tries to get good Raven to join her on the dark side, and again, if this feels like a story you've seen 100 times before, it's because you totally have, and it's over before it even starts. By far the strangest story in this collection, I think we can all agree, is the Penguin story. Yeah, old Oswald Cobblepot sees himself fighting a bunch of more evil versions of himself from the multiverse. Oswald hates these other versions because they're not refined and gentlemanly like him, and he decides that if this is going to be the end of the world, he's going to face it his way, and he even kind of becomes a bird at one point, I think. Well, didn't see that one coming. By far, though, my favorite story in this anthology is the Constantine one, mainly because the art is completely different than the rest of the book, going for a more cartoony type feel. We meet Constantine's evil doppelganger, who it seems never grew out of his heavy metal phase, where our John, of course, is all punk music all the way. Instead of fighting to the death right away, though, these two decide to sneak away and have themselves a cheeky little pint. It's here we discover that even though this is the quote-unquote evil Constantine, he's not nearly as tricky or morally dubious as the main universe Constantine, who ends up actually poisoning him. I think this is the best story too because it's the most concise. It has a beginning, middle, and end, and I really appreciate it for that. And speaking of endings, let's bring this video to an end right around here. And so that was Dark Knight's Death Metal War for the Multiverses issue number 1, and honestly, I think it's one anthology book too many. That's not to say all the stories in this are bad or anything. There's good stories in this collection, and there were good stories in the last collection and the one before that. I just wish they had trimmed a lot of the fat and just put a bunch of the good stories together in one anthology. That way I wouldn't have to spend $8 a pop American on these either. Perhaps the greatest sin of death metal as an event will ultimately be that there was so much of it and that it was so inescapable and so all-encompassing. Perhaps the worst part too is just this overwhelming feeling that I know that nothing that actually happened in these anthologies is probably going to have any bearing on the finale of Death Metal anyway. Yes, it was nice to see them try and clean up some loose ends like Heroes in Crisis, but was this really the right place or time with it? And as far as the rest of the stories go, isn't this just creating more loose ends? None of it is bad, but none of it is very necessary either. Overall, I would give this one a 6 out of 10. Pretty forgettable.
Hey there everyone, Kate Joel again, and I just want to thank you so much for watching to the end of the video. It means a lot to me. And hey, if you enjoyed the book I covered in this issue and want some comics of your own, might I recommend Book Depository? It's my number one place for shopping for comic book trades. You get a great price, and if you use my link down in the description, you'll actually be helping me out at the same time. You get something, I get something, everybody wins, right? So until next time everyone, I've been Joel, and I will see you in the next video. Bye-bye.